Good morning. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. My name is Kirk Knave, one of the pastors here, and welcome to worship. Here at Braddock Street, we seek to be followers of Jesus, who love God and worship, love others in small groups, and who serve the world in mission. If you're new with us here in the room, there's a green card in the pew rack in front of you. We would encourage you to fill that out and drop it in the offering plate later and give us a chance to get to know you a little bit better. If you have a prayer request this morning, we'd like to include that in worship. There's a blue card in the pew rack in front of you. You can fill that out, and during the first hymn, our ushers will come forward and bring those up here so we can use them in worship later on. Welcome to those of you online. If you're new with us online, there's a digital sign-in sheet or sign-in card there for you, and please comment. Let us know that you're with us. I'll be checking in on my phone occasionally just to say hello, and it's great to have you with us in worship this morning. So now let us join together in worship as we stand as we are able and join in our call to worship. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Generous God, you brought us into the abundance of our inheritance. Grant us the faith to be people blossoming with honor and truth, so that we may produce bountifully the first fruits of justice and compassion, which are pleasing in your sight. Amen. Our first hymn is number 310, He Lives.
I serve a risen Savior.
He lives, he lives, Christ Jesus lives today. may be seated.
Dear brothers and sisters, my name is Jim Athern. I invite you to give your attention to the reading of the scripture this morning. From the Hebrew scriptures, the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 26, verses 12 through 15. A kind of a liturgy, if you will, for the family to use in the year of the tithe. You might be curious to know what the tithe is for. Listen for that. When you have finished paying all the tithe of your produce in the third year, which is the year of the tithe, giving it to the Levites, the aliens, the orphans, and the widows, so that they may eat their fill within your towns, then you shall say before the Lord your God, I have removed the sacred portion from the house, and I have given it to the Levites, the resident aliens, the orphans, and the widows, in accordance with your entire commandment that you commanded me. I have neither transgressed nor forgotten any of your commandments. I have not eaten of it while in mourning. I have not removed any of it while I was unclean. And I have not offered any of it to the dead. I have obeyed the Lord my God, doing just as you commanded me. Look down from your holy habitation from heaven and bless your people Israel and the ground that you have given us, as you swore to our ancestors, a land flowing with milk and honey. And this is the word of God for all God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
Amen, indeed. Can we thank our choir? Right now, I'm going to try something that the last two services really just did not go for. So I'm counting on you all, okay? 11:15 service, do not let me down. Christ is risen. Thank you. All morning I have been waiting. Thank you. It's probably because I didn't warn any of them that I was going to do it. You guys got the benefit of a warning, so there we go. My name is Annalise, and I am one of the pastors here at Braddock Street, and I am so glad to be with you today as we start a new sermon series called Because He Lives, where we will be spending some time talking about what difference the resurrection of Jesus makes in our lives. And there is a little companion study that goes along with it. If you want a physical copy, there are some on the back table, the Braddock Street table by the coffee. It also went out digitally just in case we ran out, although I doubt we did. If you're in the Oglesby class, there's already a copy for you upstairs in your classroom if you didn't get it. But just so you know. So, as we answer this question together, what is it that we are called to do because He lives? Would you all please pray with me? Holy God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Do me a favor, everybody, say hello to David Titus up in the booth. He's always up there. It's easy for all of us to forget that he's up there, but he's the one that makes all of these screens run, and he is going to put up a picture for us. Thank you, David. I want to know if anyone has seen this statue before. Anybody seen it? If you saw it earlier today, that doesn't count. Okay. Does anybody know who this is? Who the statue is of? All right. Next picture, David. We'll see if that helps. So who is this? You got it. This statue is called Homeless Jesus, and it was first sculpted by a Canadian artist named Timothy Schmalz in 2013, and there are castings of this statue in many places around the world, so there are lots of places where you could go to find that specific image and get to see it in person. But when I lived in Washington, D.C., that scene of someone asleep on a park bench or something like that, it became very familiar to me. There was a church in D.C. called Capitol Hill UMC. You might be able to guess where it is located. And every single morning, they serve a free hot breakfast. And people from Wesley Seminary and from the community and from the church will get together, and very early every single morning will work to get this meal made. I got to participate my first semester at Wesley. I got to get up every morning along with everybody else and help to serve this meal. And when we would pull up to the church, there would be a lot of people just kind of waiting for us to open the doors, even though we hadn't even started cooking yet, right? There would be lines of people, and they would be hanging out around, and you would see some of them still asleep. And it was early in the morning, so they would still be asleep waiting for us to open up. And they would look a lot like that statue looked, right? They'd be wrapped up in blankets and warm coats and asleep someplace like a nearby planter box or a sidewalk or a bench. And unless you knew what you were looking for, you didn't recognize them. They seemed completely indiscriminate, faceless, like the statue. Unless you knew what you were looking for, unless you could recognize a signifying mark that let you know who it was. And once you got to know that crowd of folks that would always be there in the morning to come and get breakfast, you started to notice those things about those individuals that were asleep on the street right outside the church doors. And let me tell you, knowing who those folks were just by a glance, it made this work a whole lot harder. When someone goes from nameless and faceless and other to someone that you know by name, by their mannerisms or the sound of their laughter, it becomes a lot more difficult to just walk past them. You start to get upset about things that you might not even have noticed before, like anti-homeless architecture. It's made to encourage folks who have no choice but to sleep on the street to keep moving and find someplace else to be. It makes things impossible to sleep in them or to rest in them, or just really, really uncomfortable, right? They've got armrests unnecessarily in a bench so that it can't be slept on, or straight up spikes placed in places so that people can't sleep there. That's how we treat our neighbors. That's how my friend James was treated when he first came to DC as a war vet with physical and mental scars, absolutely no money, and little to no support left from the few remaining family members and friends that he had. He came to DC to see if he could get his benefits worked out so that hopefully he could get off of the street. Why then would he be living on the street in the first place? You might ask, if he came to DC to do that, why didn't he go check into one of the shelters? If you've spent time in DC, you know that there are a lot of them. There are a lot of shelters. There are a few reasons why it wasn't an option for James. First of all, a lot of those shelters are legitimately not safe places to be, especially if you've had run-ins with other people on the street. It's a real good place to get yourself beat up or to get all of your stuff stolen, what little things you still have and those provisions that you use every day to try and stay alive on the street, or those few precious things that you still have from your life before then, very easily could all be gone if you spend the night in some of the DC shelters. The other thing that made it so that he couldn't go be a part of those shelters is that James was an alcoholic and a drug addict, for which I do not blame him at all. The things that he had seen and experienced would drive the leaders of the temperance movement to drink, quite honestly. He just wanted a moment of peace and to quiet all of those demons in his head. And because of that, he needed to live on the street. It seems like this might not be super common knowledge. Like, if you think about it for a minute, you might kind of understand this, but it's really hard to get things like your government benefits if you don't have a permanent address or a valid ID. Imagine needing to get someplace in the city, not having the ability to call a taxi, you don't have your own car, you don't have money for a bus or for the metro, all of your friends are either busy or you've, you know, just not available at that time, or maybe you've just made them angry recently and they say, no thank you, I'm not giving you a ride today. And then you might miss out on a really important appointment or something like that. Imagine if you needed to go to the doctor's office and you've had to reschedule your appointment so many times that you've gotten pushed way down their priority list because they know you're unreliable. They need that slot for somebody else. Why would they save it for you if you're not going to show up? Or imagine if what had been missed was a parole officer meeting. Then you're probably going to end up back in jail just because you didn't have a way to get there. I could go on, but later on in this same series, Pastor Kirk is going to give us an entire message about the importance of sheltering our neighbors. So I'll just stop, but I'll say this. The first time that I saw the homeless Jesus statue, I immediately thought of my friend James. I imagined what it would be like if that statue just kind of sat up right beside me. And I imagined that the face of Jesus would be a whole lot like the face of James. He would be broken, but not yet defeated, cold and hungry and haunted, but still feisty and with a great sense of humor. He would be craving community and conversation, and to be seen and known and loved, to be called by name, and to have his humanity restored. That's what I see when I look at the homeless Jesus statue. And it is that image in my heart that makes me rejoice even more at the image of the empty tomb. Maybe for me, it's more like an empty bench. Does that make sense? Maybe that's why the sight of those benches with the weird armrests and the spikes really, really upsets me. Because what we do to our neighbors, we do to Christ. Timothy Schmalz said that the inspiration for the statue came from that Matthew 25 passage that I just kind of paraphrased. The gospel calls us to take the gifts and the privileges and the resources that we have been given and to use them to care for others. This concept is not just found in the New Testament. Christians, followers of Jesus, we did not invent this. We got it from the Jewish tradition, from the Hebrew Bible, which is one of the reasons why we are heading all the way nearly back to the beginning of the Bible to answer a question about what to do about things that happen at the end of it, right? No matter how you feel about things like government assistance programs, it's important to remember that when the book of Deuteronomy was written, those things did not exist. The only way that an impoverished person could survive without resorting to means that were illegal or immoral was that they would only survive by the generosity of their neighbors. Imagine what it might be like to live with no safety net. If your spouse died, or a parent left, or you were born with a disability, or you gained one in life, there would be nothing keeping you from poverty and marginalization except the kindness and generosity of the community around you. If we take Scripture seriously, then we know that God is very concerned about this. We are told countless times that we are to have a particular concern for the orphan, for the widow, for the resident alien, for the sick, the imprisoned, and those in need of healing. In other words, the most vulnerable people and the outcasts are the ones that should be at the forefront of our minds and always in our hearts, because those people are daily on the heart and mind of God. Chapter 26 of Deuteronomy contains what is called the First Fruits Liturgy, as Pastor Jim told us, in which Moses gives the people words to speak as they are observing the First Fruits Festival. During that festival, people would bring their tithe from the produce that had just become harvestable. It's literally the first things that they are able to gather in. 10% of that is what they are offering back to God. This food would go to two main places. One would be to support the priests, because they're called to work in the temple for God and for the people. They might be doing less agricultural work than other folks would be doing. So to help offset that, the people make sure that the priests have enough to eat and survive and take care of their own families. And the other place that it would go would be to those in need. And since every household was expected to make this tithe of first fruits in this three-year cycle, there would end up being a really good supply of food available for those who were in need of it. The words that we read from chapter 26 are a part of a liturgy. They would be spoken aloud in the same way that we would read a collective prayer or take membership vows or recite the creed. This is a part of worship, and it helped the Israelites to remember that they were once in need of the same provision that and God provided it for them, and therefore it's their job to pay that blessing forward for those in need now. They're all immigrants to this land and should care for the new immigrants in the land as God cared for them. Now, to be fair, the word immigrant is doing a whole lot of work in this sentence, right? It might be better to call these folks conquerors, to be quite honest. So let's take a moment to just like sigh deeply, right? And mourn for all of the nations and the people that have been conquered or eradicated because of the absolute colonial nonsense that came out of this piece of scripture, okay? So we're all gonna take a deep breath. We're gonna let that out. And we're going to say, either together or in your own heart, just, God have mercy. God have mercy. The First Fruits Festival is akin to something like our celebration of Thanksgiving. It's all about gratitude. The people are thankful to the land for producing so that they can all stay alive, and they're thankful to God for giving them that land. The proper response to these feelings of gratitude are twofold. One, the people must worship and praise God for providing for and for loving them. And two, the people must ensure that the gifts that God has given them are distributed equitably to everyone in the community. So they tithe 10% of their first fruits, and they trust God that there will be enough for all of the families and for everyone in need. My pagan friends, and yes, I do have pagan friends, no, they are not evil, and only like two of them ever try to sacrifice a goat, okay? That's completely a joke. All of my pagan friends love goats and would never harm them, okay? Just so that we're clear. My pagan friends often remind me that our celebration of Easter has been highly syncretized. In other words, the way that we celebrate Easter now has come into contact and has been molded and changed by its interaction with paganism, and that informs the way that we celebrate and when we celebrate the resurrection. There are some Christians who get really upset about that idea. They don't like the concept that paganism has ever in any way influenced Christianity. But the thing is, I think that this means that there's something deeply held within humanity, deeper than maybe we've ever been able to really fully understand, that tells us that there is a human need to experience rebirth, to experience new life and the hope that that brings. There is a deeply intrinsic human need for that. And so we look to our source of life, we look to Jesus as that hope and that celebration and that understanding of what a new start and rebirth mean to all of us. I think there's something really beautiful about that. So as we think about the best ways for us to express our love of Christ and our gratitude for Jesus' salvific acts of love through his life and death and resurrection, we should kind of get back to basics. We should ask the question, what's the best way to thank God for our salvation? Scripture tells us that we're called to pay our blessings forward. True worship, true faith, looks like loving God and loving neighbor. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what good is that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. But someone will say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith apart from your works, and by my works I will show you my faith. You believe that God is one, you do well. Even the demons believe and shudder. This passage from the book of James has caused several centuries of drama, especially between Catholics and Protestants. Being Protestants, we believe that we are saved sola fide, by faith alone. Now, to be completely fair to our Catholic brothers and sisters, that is also what they believe, okay? But we had a big fight over it a long time ago, and Protestant-Catholic grudges go deep, as you know. So, want to state for the record that our Catholic brothers and sisters are not heretics. They also believe this. Got it? Good? Thank you. But we did fight over it. So, only through God's grace, Jesus' death and resurrection, and by the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives, can we enter God's kingdom. There is a danger in this theology, though, because it creates a loophole. There's no need to really care for your neighbors or your fellow members of creation. There's no need for empathy, compassion, or good works. All you need is faith. Doesn't necessarily need to lead us to action. Faith doesn't even need to lead us to change our personal character or behavior. As long as I say, Jesus, I am a sinner and you are my savior, then I'm good and I can treat people however I'd like. We can exploit them, we can abuse them, we can enslave them, we can harm them, we can neglect them, we can put spikes outside of our businesses because maybe a homeless person might hang out there and, oh, heaven forbid, we turn away any business because someone that we don't like is sitting in our doorstep, right? Obviously, God forgives, so as long as I say I'm sorry and that I believe in Jesus, then I get to go to heaven, and that's the point. If that doesn't sound quite correct to you, then let me say I agree. This is a problem that Protestants sometimes run into when we take a really hard stance against works righteousness. We forget that faith is supposed to lead us into action. The action itself is not what gains us entry into heaven. But if we take our faith seriously and let it overtake all aspects of our lives, then we'll be compelled to care for others as God cares for us. The love of God goes hand in hand with the love of neighbor. I would argue that something has gone wrong in your faith journey if you love God but do not love your neighbor. And to be clear, love is a verb. Love is faith in action. Love is not just recognizing the sacred worth of every human being, but also doing your best to help people live as though they are people with sacred worth. That means making sure that they have the basics covered: food and shelter and clothing and community and safety. And it is especially important for us to care for the most vulnerable members of our society, the least, the lost, the lonely, and the left out. So the next time that you see someone sleeping on the street or come across someone who is panhandling on the side of the road, I really hope that this is the image that pops into your mind. Remember that how you treat that person is how you're treating Jesus. God with skin on, who lived a human life and died on a cross and rose from the dead because of how much he loves you. So how will you respond because you know he lives? Let us pray. Holy God, the grave could not keep you. Love has won and love will keep winning. Teach us how to love like you. Help us to see you in every person that we meet and to treat them as we would treat you. Fill us with grace and mercy and empathy and a love of justice. As we continue to celebrate your resurrection today, we ask for an extra helping of your presence and your love to be with many people who are near and far away but are on our hearts today. And that includes Harold Ogg and Lucinda Angel, Kay Umps, Brenda Stiff, Dr. Curtis Thwing and family, Don McCrum, John Lobb, Heidi Lucas, Denny Bromley, Shirley Peterson, Ralph and Dee Grimm, Melissa Schatzer, Marie Snow, Jessica, Matt, and Zach Feuer, Steve and Gloria Buchanan, the family of Dick Wydell, Marianne Martin, and all of those that we hold now in our hearts. Holy God, many of us also remember that today, 16 years ago, a tragedy happened here in our own state at Virginia Tech, and we ask that you would continue to be with those that were affected greatly by that day, all of the families and all of the people that lost friends and family and loved ones. God, we also pray for the people of Louisville dealing with their own issues with gun violence. God, we really need help on this one and ask that you would bring us some really clear answers. We also pray for peace in Ukraine, knowing that there have to be better solutions than this. God, we are thankful today for the lives of new humans in our midst, and especially for the life of Samuel Conrad LaRosa and his mom, Emily, and his family. God, we pray all of these things In the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
At this time, we're going to show our love for God through our giving, and we just want to lift up one of the things that you make possible through your giving, and that is Camp Overlook. If you haven't been with our church or our denomination, you may not know that very often we share ownership of a retreat camp. We share this with other districts. It is located in Keeseltown, Virginia. If you don't know where that is, it's just northeast of Harrisonburg here in the Blue Ridge Mountains. It's a place where we have summer camps for children and many other retreat opportunities, and it's just one of the things that we make possible because of your giving. And I want to ask our ushers to come forward at this time. Holy God, from the first fruits, we offer these gifts as an expression of our love for you because you first loved us. Transform them into gifts for others. that our neighbors as well might feel your love and compassion. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. I invite you to join with me now as we reaffirm our Christian faith in the historic words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our final hymn is number 364, Because He Lives.
Thank you.
It has been a great honor and privilege to be in worship with you all today. Thank you for being here. One thing we want you to know as you go forward through into this week is that it is time, get excited, it is time to sign up to volunteer for VBS. And you can do that at the table in the gathering space in the corner. You'll see all of the star things, which is very cool. And you can figure out right at that table what would be a great way for you to plug in and help us out with VBS. It is such an important ministry in our congregation and in our community. We give a safe place for kids to come and learn about Jesus. So thank you already for all of you. I know are going to go straight to that table and sign up. So thank you for that in advance, okay? Here's your benediction. Now go in peace to serve God and your neighbor in all that you do. May those in this world to whom love is a stranger find in you most generous friends. And may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.